but thieves are also fairly enterprising. Anytime a new technology comes on board, they think about ways in which can be exploited.
And really, unless you decode this QR code, you have no way to tell that there is a malicious link in there. So that's really the threat.
This is the Discovery Files podcast from the U.S. National Science Foundation. I'm Nate Podker. The development of barcodes allowed information to be encoded into a black and white image that could be scanned with laser technologies. The adoption of barcodes has broadly impacted inventory management, and adding pricing information has transformed our checkout experience at grocery stores. Today, quick response or QR codes are scanned by smart devices for restaurant menus, parking payments, or flight boarding passes. But malicious users can take advantage of the technology for phishing and other criminal activities. We're joined by Gaurav Sharma, professor of electrical and computer engineering, computer science, and biostatistics and computational biology, as well as Irving Barron, assistant professor of electrical and computer engineering, both at the University of Rochester, where they're working on new forms of more secure QR codes. Thank you both for joining me today.
It's my pleasure to join you, Nate.
Thank you, Nathan, for having me here. It's a pleasure.
So I want to start with the big question. What are QR codes?
So QR codes are these 2D barcodes, which are encoding digital information in the form of a machine-readable image format. So just like you have these UPC barcodes, which are traditional 1D barcodes, which encode these products that we buy at grocery stores and other departmental stores, these are 2D versions of those codes.
Do they function the same way on the back end? Like, is the technical way these things work the same?
I think that technologies are somewhat different. The traditional 1D barcodes are designed for reading with specialized laser scanners. As technology has evolved, image sensors have become really cheap and ubiquitous because you have them everywhere in our smartphones and in our tablet devices. So that's become a much more cheaper alternative for reading images. And that has really provoked this revolution in people trying to use these 2D barcodes. And QR codes are one instantiation of this. There are also other 2D barcodes that are actually coming into this space.
How does the camera sensor read the barcode?
So the camera sensor actually just senses an image, and the QR code is designed in a particular way such that localization, which is finding out where the barcode is designed to be very efficient and fast. So it's essentially doing some very quick scanning to figure out where in the image a barcode is located. And once it locates the barcode, then the process is really, the location markers break up the field into small squares. And whether the square is lighter or darker determines whether you've got a one or a zero in that particular square. So those squares are called modules.
So the rise of smartphones, I think, is correlated with seeing these becoming more popular. Like, I feel like I started seeing them in the late 2000s, maybe. How did it move from being a tool for logistics to being a mainstream advertising piece?
A couple of things. Firstly, I think the company which invented this technology, they made it available openly. So that allowed people to adopt it easily. The technology is quite robust in the sense that there is good error correction built into this so that you can capture it in spite of some distortions. So you will typically see this in the form of beautification, where people will take a small segment of the QR code and replace it with a logo. So that's deliberately cannibalizing a small region of the image to put a logo in, and the error correction is so robust that you can still recover it. So that's what prompted this. And among the different technologies, the QR codes happen to be the ones which are actually probably the most robust in my experience. So there are a variety of 2D barcode technologies, but 2D QR codes tend to be the most robust.
So I think that rise in popularity has made it more of a potential target for phishing. Like, criminals will take advantage of new opportunities and new technologies in that kind of way. Can you talk a little bit about what makes a QR code so susceptible to phishing or quishing scams?
So we tend to think about good people being the enterprising ones, but thieves are also fairly enterprising. Anytime a new technology comes on board, they think about ways in which can be exploited. So a QR code was something which would conveniently allow somebody to connect to an online resource. So for instance, you want to connect to your bank on your smartphone. Rather than type in the long URL, you could just have a QR code which gives you a pointer to that and allows you to connect there. Okay. So now enterprising folks figure out that this is a way they can try and direct you to a site which looks like your bank site, but is not really your bank site. And then they can get you to the sort of give to them your confidential information, which you should not be giving. That's one use case. There's also other use cases as in any kind of technology which is used. People will come out with different ways. So for instance, municipalities put on these QR codes on parking meters as a way to pay for parking. And again, enterprise individuals thought it would be a nice thing. They could paste their own QR codes on top and redirect the payments themselves rather than to the municipality. And that's really a double whammy because you both get a parking ticket and also you have paid money to some thieves.
And really, unless you decode this QR code, you have no way to tell that there is a malicious link in there. So that's really the threat, that people are so used now to scan QR codes because you use them for two-factor authentication, you use it to see a restaurant menu. It is such a commodity now that you don't think twice to scan it in an email, especially because if you are in a workplace where they use specifically QR codes for some authentication procedures, then people immediately trust and scan. So that's the risk of phishing over phishing. So because the email security nowadays, they are working though in improving that aspect, but it's not there yet. So these malicious QR codes get to people. And bad actors love them because they might build these malicious websites. But if people do not visit the websites, they don't get the juicy information they are after, right? So QR codes, in a way, are a perfect vehicle for them to obfuscate their intentions.
Is there a way for the consumer or the user or an average person clicking through a QR code to know that it's a secure link?
Sure, that's a great question. And multiple, both private companies and other researchers have proposed solutions. And immediately what I can think of is there are antivirus apps, maybe in the Google Play Store, App Store, that let you know if the QR code, not the QR code, the link that you are trying to visit is malicious because they have maybe a registry of different fake websites or something like that. However, one other thing that QR codes facilitate these bad actors is the use of shortening services. So when you do like an online QR code created thing, you're going to get a short version of the malicious website. So when the solution, the antivirus app, let's call it like that, scans this QR code, is going to see, oh, this is just a shortened URL. And unless it does more to identify where it is going, then you might still be falling for the scam. But yes, there are some measures, but this is the endless cat and mouse chase. Bad actors are always trying to see how they can circumvent these security measures. And of course, people who work on security are always trying to make their bad intentions harder.
Right. That shortened link thing makes me think of some of the phishing schemes you see with emails where the address is almost right, but not quite.
And if you think about it, you are putting pressure on the user to be the one to judge that link. And let's be honest, most people, including myself, I don't go through a, let's say, 100-character web link going character by character to see if it is actually a true or not website or URL. Mm-hmm.
So moving into your research, you have an approach that might make these a lot safer. Can you talk a little bit about the self-authenticating dual modulation approach?
The name just roll off of the tongue, right? So basically, what we did is we started with creating and developing a new design that builds on top of the QR code framework. And that's what we call a dual modulated QR code. Now, here, basically, we have used oriented elliptical dots instead of the traditional square modules that you can find in QR codes to embed an additional layer of information. Now, with this additional information comes the self-authentication part. We create a digital signature of the, let's use an example, the link to a bank website login page. So we have that URL that we communicate through the regular QR code message. And then we use the additional layer of information to create a digital signature of that bank URL, the authentic bank URL. Now you need some trusted authority. Let's, for the sake of argument, say Google or Apple, which are the, as you might know, the two big players on mobile development and mobile operating systems. So they say, yes, this is actually a trusted website. So you have the signature, you have the website. Now, when you try to decode it or capture it with your camera, there is already software that is going to check the website, the signature, and is going to say, okay, this particular website was signed by Apple, and therefore I can trust that it's going to be an honest website. However, if you do not have that signature, you can let the user know, hey, you know what? You have this link in this QR code. I was not able to say who created it or who signed it. So it is up to you if you decide that you want to continue, or we can be more aggressive and straight up don't allow it to continue. So the authentication happens in the device itself. We do not need to go or have an internet connection to request, okay, let's compare if this is actually authentic. No, all you need is within the QR code itself, well, the barcode, let's generalize, and the software in your smartphone.
And for the user, that really reinforces the security when your device is confirming that the link is legitimate before you even have a chance to look at the link.
That's right. That's right. Because if you already followed the link in some sense, then you possibly expose yourself to malware. And this is sort of a key thing in security. Often the focus is initially on functionality, on first getting the functionality, and security comes as an afterthought. So in many applications, that becomes a challenge because you already have something deployed. Now you're trying to retrofit security, and you want to do that in a way that does not break things. So that's where the dual modulation is particularly advantageous. Because as I mentioned, the primary application is not impacted at all. The primary data you've embedded in the QR code is not impacted at all by the dual modulation.
I understand you're working on other strategies such as adding color to QR codes as well.
Color is a different kind of degree of freedom that you have, these smartphone devices. We actually explored that also extensively. That was the first direction we started on, was looking at color. And the unique aspect in our approach was to do things in a modular fashion. So if you look at color displays, for example, they use red, green, and blue channels. Okay, so our approach was unique in the sense that we can do one barcode in each of the channels. And what you get at the other end when you capture an image, you get cross-coupling between the channels. And there we can employ machine learning techniques to understand what is the nature of coupling and undo it. And now we can actually do a combination of both these techniques also. We can do the dual modulation as well as the color, to get about 6 times as much data within the same footprint.
What is the path forward to get this research out into widespread use for consumers? I believe your NSF iCorps award has to do with this translational aspect.
So while we didn't get NSF support for the research part, we did get the NSF support in the form of the National iCorps program and also the regional iCorps program. I'm not going to go too much into detail unless you want me to, but in this program, what they teach you is how to get out of your building, your research building, and talk to people, right? See what they need, see if what you're building is actually something that they would like to have, buy, or yeah, something that would make their lives better. And I believe, personally, after going through all this experience, that it is as important as the research work. Because at the end of the day, what I learned is the customer or potential customer does not care, usually, if you found a very elegant mathematical way to create these elliptical dots and you develop a statistical model such that the error correction is better. What they care about is, what can your research, your product, do for me to solve my issues? Right now, we have several journal publications and conference publications. We have already validated all the science. We have a prototype working, but our prototype is on a traditional computer. So you need to take a picture, put that into the computer, and then do the decoding. And people, definitely, nobody wants to do that. You don't want to carry a computer, capture a QR code, and do the authentication in your PC. You want to do it in your smartphone, right? So that's the first thing we want to do. We want to develop this mobile app to better showcase the seamless authentication that you can achieve with the SDM QR codes. Then, once we have that, the next step, really, as I mentioned, we require a trusted authority, someone that can be the one saying, yes, these URLs, these web links, this content is safe to follow. And we can think nobody better than Apple and Google themselves, for the reasons I already mentioned, to be these trusted authorities. So then I would like to think that we need to approach somehow and expose our case and see if we can go from there. But I think that would be the easiest way to adoption, having them come together and working with us to put this in your camera such that tomorrow you can just use what you already have and you have the additional protection. If we are not able to do that, then we might go a different route. Maybe we try to go partner with other companies that work with QR codes, barcode decoders, and they might be interested in adopting this additional layer of security and maybe go from there.
The broader application space we think about is broader than just the specific aspect that we talked about anti-phishing. So for instance, a lot of applications, there's interest in track and trace. If you're looking at supply chains, now there's interest in trying to figure out whether you maintain the integrity of the entire supply chain and can establish how things travel through that. So we're also exploring that space in our efforts at looking at commercialization of the technologies.
For my last question to each of you, I want to think about the future and what's ahead. Professor Sharma, where do you see this technology going in the next 10 years, let's say?
So the UPC, traditional UPC, universal product code, that was the 1D barcode that we're all familiar with, is increasingly being replaced by 2D versions, either the data matrix or the QR code that we talk about. Okay. So now as that's happening, what dual modulation allows us is the ability to add a new functionality transparently to what is being done with the primary application. And that's really quite helpful because you can think about things that are standardized. So there's a global standardization initiative called GS1, which standardizes these 2D barcode for product labeling. If it's standardized, then the challenge is it's great that you have interoperability, but the challenge is any additional innovation you want to introduce on top of it becomes difficult to introduce because you've got to now argue with the standard. So what our dual modulation allows us to do this is transparently we can add new functionality. And that's what we're exploring through this border. We've got an NSF ICORPS grant through which we are actually exploring this idea of broader applications for the technology and seeing which one is the sweet spot that we'd like to address first.
How about you, Professor Barron? Where would you like to see this technology go in the next decade?
QR codes in general, I think they are going to stick around for some time. Specifically, recently, the traditional rectangular barcode is being phased away by GS1. And they are going to really push the adoption of QR codes, if I remember correctly, data matrix codes, other 2D barcodes. So they are going to stick. How long? I don't know, but based on what we have seen with the traditional rectangular barcode, I am sure it would be 10 years, addressing your question. At least 10 years. Yes. Now, regarding of where do I see our particular research going forward is, well, there are needs that we found in the National ICORPS Teams program that we believe we can address by doing some additional research and some additional development. Without going too much into the specifics, but we live in a world where we require more and more information to be communicated. That's just increasing, right? So as I said, QR codes have been around for a long time, and we really want to pack as much information as possible in these guys without making them unnecessarily big. And this is particularly important in packaging, where real estate is a premium. So that's one possible research direction where we might go and solve that issue of packing as much information as possible while keeping readability and as much compatibility as possible.
Special thanks to Gaurav Sharma and Irving Barron. For the Discovery Files, I'm Nate Podker. Please subscribe wherever you get podcasts, and if you like our program, share with a friend and consider leaving a review. Discover how the U.S. National Science Foundation is advancing research at nsf.gov.